Yes, dear students, let's start. Today is lecture number 3. Lecture number 3, and this I am recording for students from South India. For students who would like to study the lectures in English. I have my Hindi version also, but this is the English version. So are we ready? So types of contract. So we already know what do we mean by contract. So contract is an agreement which is enforceable by law. So we know this, enforceable by law. So here they have classified the contracts on the basis of validity or enforceability, or how the contract was formed. How can a contract be formed? If you just say it verbally, that means you just expressed yourself. So that is called express contract. Oh my God, I did not say anything, but still there was a duty and rights without saying. Yes, it can happen. Can you imagine a situation where without even uttering a word, you get into some sort of a right or a duty? There are situations. Then we have quasi-contract. Quasi-contract means where actually there was nothing called contract, no formation of contract. There were no two parties who intended to get into a contract, but government or law, they have given you some duties. We'll discuss about this. Then these days, e-commerce contracts, all what we buy from Amazon is like an e-commerce contract. Based on performance, if your contract is executed, you go to a grocery shop, you just pay 500 rupees, you take the sugar, both the parties have done their job, contract is over, executed contract. Nothing remains to be performed. Performance, see, this is under the heading of performance. When nothing remains to be performed, contract is executed. That means contract is performed. Two parties, and both the parties have performed their duties. So this is called executed contract. Executory. Executory means one party has still to perform his duties. Executory. One party, or it can be both the parties. Yes, because we have classified it into two aspects. Unilateral and bilateral. Unilateral means one party. And bilateral means both the parties. We'll take some examples. We'll read. And here we are. When all the test is passed, it is valid contract. Void contract, which is void ab initio? No. Void contracts. That means at the time when the contract was made, everything was in order, but later on, at a later stage, something happened. Something happened, and now the judge or the law will not enforce the contract. Can you imagine any situation? Let's say somebody who was supposed to do his duty is dead. Now, can the law enforce the dead person? Hey, dead man, come on, get up. You're bound to perform this obligation of yours. Come on, get up and do. So it is becomes unenforceable. So void contracts. Now this contract cannot be enforced. So we would study all those points in details. Just get an overview. So there can be a situation when the agreement crossed all the stages. It became a valid contract, but later on, we call it as supervening impossibility. Impossibility. There can be one more example. A ship was coming from London to India. And in that ship, there was an air condition. I sold that air condition to my friend Bansal. But that ship sunk. And there is no chance that ship would come back again, because it's The ship is more or less sunk. More or less, no, it's absolutely sunk. There is no chance whatsoever that the ship will come to Kolkata port. So there is no chance I can give the air conditioner to Bansal, my friend. So this is a void contract. Earlier when the ship was floating, everything was perfect. But now there is no chance. I cannot perform this. And nobody can enforce me. The court cannot force me. Where that ship is sunk, you go down to the ocean. You are bound by law. It is a legal, valid contract. Come on, you take whatever divers, but you have to perform. No, my lord, I cannot. And nobody will force you. So this is where we understand void contracts. Coming to voidable contracts. Voidable means you have an ability, a special power, and this special power is given to the weaker party or the aggrieved party, where the consent was not free. And we have studied earlier, there are cases in case of fraud, mistake, misrepresentation, undue influence, coercion. We will study all these topics in details. Under such circumstances, the weaker party has the power, has the right to not perform the obligation which he was supposed to perform under the contract. Why he will not perform, under what basis he will not perform, and why the court will not even force him to perform. See, in the case of void contracts, the court or the law would not apply any pressure. Zero. Zero pressure. In this case, the weaker party will go to the court and ask the court, ki court, you please do not apply any pressure. That means please keep your pressure to the zero level. And why should the court keep the pressure to the zero level? In my case, see, because I was forced. This contract was a forced contract. This contract was a contract under mistake. This contract was a contract under undue influence. So please, I would not like to get into this contract. Please help me get out of this contract. Because a contract has to happen with absolute free will. There can be no force. If you are happy, I am happy. We want to get into this relationship. We want to get into this contract, obligation, duty. Then it's fine. But if something is happening out of force, out of ignorance, out of fraudulent activities, out of coercion, out of undue influence, no. I don't want to perform my duty as per the contract. Why I don't perform? Because I don't feel like. And it was not my free will. I was forced into it. But, you enter a contract as out of your free will. Later on, you cannot say, ki now I don't feel like. I enter into a contract, you give me 2 lakhs, I give you my car. And this contract was absolutely a fair and a valid contract with no force, and the consent was absolutely free consent. Everything was in place. Later on, somebody comes and offers me 2.5 lakhs. And now I say, now I don't feel like. No, then it is not the right thing to do. That means you are a greedy person. So basically, there is a very superbly explained example of gunpowder and matchstick. Gunpowder and matchstick was explained by offer and acceptance. So if there's an original good offer and originally good acceptance, free consent was there, no malafide, nothing was wrong. So gunpowder meets the matchsticks, explosion. You cannot bring back the gunpowder. So once there was a right offer and a proper acceptance, so it comes to a stage of contract. So illegal agreements, we have discussed it, illegal agreements when the object or the consideration is unlawful. So whatever you are entering is illegal agreement. Unenforceable contracts. Unenforceable contracts. Some technical defect is there. Technical defect is there, and the court would not get this contract enforced. We would read it. What can be the technical defects? Let's say we had discussed that insurance contract should be in writing, or a property should be registered. It's not registered. So it is unenforceable contract due to the technical default or fault. So let's read the ICAI study material. Let's get to know what exactly we should write in the examination hall. So the language is very important, my friend. So I have already explained you, but now let's read it just for the sake of writing in the examination hall. So we can just go at a quick pace, because whatever needs to be explained has already been done properly. So just understand the language. Nothing is left. Valid contract. An agreement which is binding and enforceable is a valid contract. The word is to be noted is binding and enforceable. Is a valid contract. It contains all the essential elements of a valid contract. We have already discussed all the essential elements as per section 10 as well as the other points. Void contract. Section 2J states as follows. A contract which ceases to be enforceable. Ceases to be enforceable. So all of a sudden this has as if you have a clock or you have a watch. And this watch was absolutely fine. All of a sudden, this watch stopped. This watch has stopped. So ceases means which was running, which was in order. Now it is all of a sudden it stops. So a contract, when the contract was alive or where the contract was in order, it had to be performed. That means the duty to perform. The duty to perform was on, but now that duty to perform has ceased. That means the duty to perform is now off. No need to perform. No need to perform. Why no need to perform? There can be a change of law. Let's say government has banned plastic. There was a contract between A and B for sale of 1 lakh plastic bags. But now government has banned the sale of plastic bags. So the duty to supply the plastic bag was on. But the moment the law came, now nobody will deal in plastic bags. And all the buying and selling of plastic bags needs to be banned with immediate effect. So the contract which was valid, now this contract has ceased. Cease means stop. Put a stop to this contract. No need to honor this contract. Why? Because the law of the land, the law of the country is higher to what mutual rights and duties both the parties had created. So a contract which ceases to be enforceable by law becomes void when it ceases to be enforceable. So ceases to be enforceable because the court of law will not enforce. Why? Because the law of the land has made up a new law to ban the sale of plastics. Ban on the sale of plastics. So if there is a existing ban, if I go to the court, court will say, no, I will not enforce this contract because it is against the law. Now enforcing this contract means the status has changed. This has become an illegal. So this has become illegal. It is against the law. I cannot enforce it. Now the law has changed. You cannot trade in plastic bags. So this is when the law changes, or if the person who was alive is dead. The ship which was supposed to come has sunk, or the fire has caught the factory. The factory which was supposed to supply sugar, that factory has caught fire. Nothing can be done. Impossible. So a situation has come where it is impossible to perform the contract. So when the law changes, it is due to the law of the land. And in case of certain situation where performing the duty has become impossible, so then we understand the term void contract. Thus, a void contract is one which cannot be enforced by a court of law. Example, you can just read it on your own. It is about a publisher who died. Another example is about a sugar factory where the factory caught fire. So you can read this on your own. Well, it may be added by way of clarification here that when a contract is void, it is not a contract at all. Absolutely correct. Contract is void. That means it is no longer a contract. But for the purpose of identifying it, it has to be called a void contract. Just to identify it. It was earlier valid, now void. So the next point is voidable contract. Voidable contract. Section 2I defines that an agreement which is enforceable by law at the option of one or more parties thereto, but not at the option of the other or others, is a voidable contract. Why they're writing other or others? Because see, if it is contract between A and B, it is one party, another party. But let's say here it is ABC versus DEF. So it is other or others. So it is singular and plural, nothing much to comprehend. This in fact means that one of the parties to an agreement is in the position or is legally entitled or authorized. So point to be noted is he is in a position legally entitled or authorized to avoid performing his part. Avoid performing his part. In a contract, it is the duty to perform. But the weak party, the aggrieved party, he is in a position, he is legally entitled or authorized to avoid, means I will not perform, I will not perform. See, previously there used to be a case, if you not perform your part, I will take you to the court. And here the person is saying, I am not going to perform. You want to take me to the court? Come, take me to the court. I am not scared of the court. I am not scared of the judge. Oh, I will go and tell the judge. Judge sahab, he was telling he was not scared of the judge. He's not scared of the law. Yes, I am not scared. Because the law has given me the right. If somebody kidnaps your daughter and then forces me to perform the duty, so what do you want? Now my daughter is in my house. Singham brought my daughter back to my house. I am not scared of you, man. Come on, you take me wherever you want to take me. So he is authorized. He is in the position. He is in the position. He is authorized. He is legally entitled. So now he is in the position. That time when the daughter was kidnapped, what will a father do? His 1 crore property, he was selling at 10 lakh rupees. Why? Because Robin had kidnapped the daughter of Ashok. But now he is in the position because Singham had rescued his daughter. He is legally entitled. Legally entitled means this contract. He is legally entitled because the law is giving him the permission. if the contract was entered under coercion, so there's a permission by the law. The law is giving you the power. So he's legally entitled. He's authorized by law. Don't worry, you need not perform. Then the agreement is treated and becomes voidable. So you were in the position, you are in the position to treat this agreement as voidable. You have the ability to make this agreement, cancel this agreement. You have the ability to cancel your part of performance because you are legally entitled, you are authorized, you need not perform. Such a right might arise from the fact that the contract may have been brought. From where is this person getting the right? Because the contract may have been brought about by one of the parties by coercion. So you get a right, you get a right, you get that legally entitlement only if the contract was brought by coercion. If the contract was brought by undue influence, if the contract was brought by fraud, misrepresentation, and hence the other party has the right to treat it as a voidable contract. So in such situations, I will not perform my duty as per the contract because this contract was brought into effect by fraud, by coercion, by misrepresentation, by mistake. So we come to a very interesting junction right now. At this juncture, it would be desirable to know the distinction between a void contract and voidable contract. So we already discussed in quite detail about void contract. So now they would like to test us by telling us the difference between void contract and voidable contract. My friends, if you have listened to whatever I spoke with apt attention, I'm very sure you would find it absolutely easy to understand the difference between void contract and voidable contract. The distinction lies in three aspects, namely definition, nature, and rights. These are elaborated here under. Definition. A void contract cannot be enforced at all. There is no chance of getting it enforced. A voidable contract is an agreement which is enforceable only at the option of one of the parties, but not at the option of the other. Therefore, enforceability or otherwise divides the two types of contracts. So a voidable contract where one party who is the aggrieved party generally, if he or she keeps quiet, allows the contract to be enforced, the contract gets enforced. But the person who had force the other party to get into a contract. Let's say, please understand this. I had put a gun or I had kidnapped someone's daughter. Like in the previous example, Robin and Ashok. So, Ashok being the aggrieved party can always say that I don't want to perform my duty. So the option is with Ashok. But one thing which really, I think sometimes, will Robin go to the court of law? Will Robin go to the court of law to get it enforced? Will the situation come when Robin will go to the court of law? Robin will not go to the court of law. Think practically. And will a situation arise where Robin has to go to court of law? That situation will never come. Because Robin will threaten. I will kill your daughter. I will kill your daughter. I will kill your daughter. kill your daughter. So in this case, Ashok is absolutely scared. If this fellow Robin kills my daughter, if my daughter is killed, then fine. If I'm ready to get my daughter killed, then anyways, I'm not transferring this property. Okay, you kill my daughter, fine. I'm not going to give you my property. But in case if Ashok is really scared, he will sign the paper, the contract will get executed, he will get his daughter back. So in all the cases, Robin, who is the main culprit, he will not go to the court to get it enforced. So these are the practical aspects. But in case if Ashok is in a situation, if Ashok is in a situation now, his daughter is back, Singham has given back his daughter. Now this fellow Robin is trying to act smart. Now this fellow Robin, okay, even if you got your daughter back, don't worry, I still have this contract paper which you signed. Okay, come, let's go to the court. You sign, you have my signature, okay, still I will not honor this contract. Then this fellow Ashok will tell the judge, Judge Saab, I had to sign this paper. And Judge Saab, just imagine, why would I sell the property which is of value 1 crore rupees for 10 lakh rupees? I was under force, I was under coercion. Judge Saab, please investigate. So this is how this situation arises. This is how the situation can be settled. So the line is, a voidable contract is an agreement which is enforceable only at the option of one of the parties, but not at the option of the other. Therefore, enforceability or otherwise divides their type of contract. So one party can enforce. Thank you. the next point is nature. Nature. By nature, a void contract is valid at the time when it is made, but becomes unenforceable and thus void on account of subsequent developments. So when it was made, it was absolutely perfect. On subsequent development, something happened after the contract was made, or events like supervening impossibility, like the ship is sunk now, nothing can be done, or subsequent illegality, like the government has banned the plastic sale. So now if you sell plastics, it will be illegal. Repudiation of a voidable contract also renders the contract void. Repudiation means cancellation of a voidable contract also renders the contract void. Now basically the court is not going to enforce it. Similarly, a contingent contract might become void. What is contingent contract? We will study this at a later stage, but I will just explain you right now. Contingent means happening, you're not sure about it. So if the ship comes, I will give you this AC. The ship never came, so I will never give you. So we'll discuss this contingent aspects a little later. So contingent contract might become void when the occurrence of the event on which it was contingent becomes impossible. So in case the ship comes, so I will give you the AC. Now the ship is sunk. So occurrence, see, there was a chance of yes and no. Contingent means there's two chances, yes or no. If the ship comes, yes. If the ship comes, then I give you the AC. Now the ship is never going to come, no, because it is sunk. So I'm never going to give you the AC. So never going to give you the AC means now it is impossible to give you the AC. It is impossible, again, the contract is void because nobody is going to enforce such a contract. Why nobody is going to enforce such a contract? Just think, because I don't want you to just mug up this the acts. Just think for a while. The ship is sunk. Now, any sensible person would not get into this. The judge is supposed to be highly sensible. The law is supposed to be highly sensible. So there's no point even going to the court. The person is dead who was supposed to make the painting. He's dead. It's impossible. Now the new law has come, which has made the old law absolutely illegal. So there's no point going to the court. So it becomes impossible. On the other hand, voidable contract would remain valid until it is rescinded. Rescinded means cancelled by the person. So we had our example, Robin and Ashok. And this fellow Robin had kidnapped the daughter of Ashok. So Ashok has to, until it is rescinded by the person who has the option to treat it as voidable. So Ashok has to cancel it, get it cancelled. But in such situation, within the situation of kidnapping, if Robin has kidnapped the daughter of Ashok, generally the contract gets executed maybe at a later stage if you complain, and maybe if you can prove and all. So that will be another situation which we'll study at a later stage. So, on the other hand, voidable contract would remain valid until it is rescinded by the person who has the option to treat it as voidable. The right to treat it as voidable does not invalidate the contract until such right is exercised. So, you need to exercise this right. All contracts caused by coercion, undue influence, fraud, misrepresentation are voidable. Generally, a contract caused by mistake is void. If it is caused by mistake, it is straight away void, straight away cancel. But on the other aspects, it is voidable, but that means somebody has to go and exercise that right. But if it is caused by mistake, no need to exercise the right, it automatically becomes void. So what are the rights? What are the rights of the person in the circumstances of a voidable contract or a void contract? As regards rights of the parties, in the case of void contract, there is no legal remedy for the parties as the contract cannot be performed in any way. See it now, that fellow M.F. Hussain is dead. Now what rights you want here? That ship is sunk. What rights you want? Nothing can be done. So just sit silent in your home. Nothing can be done. In the case of voidable contract, the aggrieved party has the right to rescind it. So right of cancellation. Right of cancellation. Where right of cancellation is in the case of voidable contract. But point to be noted is within a reasonable time. Now, a lot of students ask, sir, how do we determine reasonable time? See, this is plain simple day-to-day case and day-to-day logic. Let's say if your friend asks you for a movie, today evening show, 5 p.m. is the show. So the movie ended at 8 p.m. So 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. if is the movie, so you should reach there by 4:30, 4:55, or let's say by 5, or let's say by 5:15, 5:30. That is reasonable. Okay, you got late in traffic, 30 minutes late, okay, accepted. But if you reach next day, the movie ticket was 5 p.m. on 23rd July. Right? You reach on 24th July. So it's automatically understood what is reasonable time. So as per the situations, as per the case to case, reasonable time would be decided as per the logic. Okay. Whenever you discuss something, something reasonable will come out of it. So you need to have patience and then discuss it. If it is so rescinded, it becomes void. If it is not rescinded, it is a valid contract. So, since we have discussed everything in detail, this can be self-reading, okay? So, this is just to self-reading will help you out because it's the repetition. Illegal contract. Illegal contract. But the point is, illegal contract. If it is illegal, how it became a contract? It is a contract which the law forbids to be made. The court will not enforce such a contract. Illegal contract. Illegal agreement. So here I have my personal doubts. If it is illegal, it will never be enforced. It will never be contract. Only in one situation where it was a valid contract, later on law changed and then this contract became an illegal contract due to the change in law. But else it will be an illegal agreement. Illegal contract can only be a situation when it was made, it was valid. Now law has changed and now law will not and get it enforced. If during the time when the contract was made, if that time the existing law was already forbidding, then it will be an illegal agreement. It will never get the status of illegal contract. Example, you make a contract of murder. A and B is making a contract to murder C. This is illegal agreement. A and B is making a contract to purchase plastic bags. This is a valid contract. This is a valid contract. But now the government has realized that this plastic is not biodegradable. This plastic is really very harmful for the environment. So this plastic bags needs to be banned. And selling of plastic bag has become illegal. So this valid contract has become an illegal contract. Okay? This valid contract has become an illegal contract. The law will not enforce it. But if you are getting into an arrangement to kidnap someone, so will that be called illegal contract or illegal agreement? That is for you to think and answer. But I've explained you everything. So illegal contract, it is a contract which the law forbids to be made. So here, if this institute material is saying it is a contract which the law forbids to be made, so basically it is the agreement. It is not the contract, it is the agreement. The court will not enforce such a contract, but also the connected contracts. And illegal agreements. All illegal agreements are void, but all void agreements are not necessarily illegal. See, these are examiners' favorite things. They will put up these questions. All illegal agreements are void, but all void agreements are not necessarily illegal. Basically, agreement with a minor is, of course, it is void. But there are few agreements which invite Indian Penal Code. Those agreements which law forbids, why the law forbids? Because that is against public policy, or it is immoral agreements. So those agreements are of course illegal, but there can be situation where void agreement are not to be termed as illegal agreement. But illegal agreements are, of course, they are void from the very beginning. They are void. Example. Contract that is immoral or opposed to public policy. Immoral or opposed to public policy. Public policy means we all general people, general public. The agreement or the contract should not be made in such a way wherein the general public, they face difficulty or their life or their discipline or the society is put into some sort of danger or illegal in nature. Similarly, if R agrees with S to purchase brown sugar, this is an illegal agreement. According to Section 2G of the Indian Contract Act, an agreement not enforceable by law is void. An agreement not enforceable by law is void. The Act has specified various factors due to which an agreement may be considered as void. Void agreement. One of those factors is unlawfulness of object and consideration of the contract. That is illegality of the contract which makes it void. The illegal and void agreement differ from each other in the following respects. All illegal agreements are void, However, all void agreements are not illegal. Despite this, there is a similarity between illegal and void agreements that in both the cases it is void ab initio and cannot be enforced by law. So, void agreement or illegal agreement, they both are void ab initio. What do we mean by ab initio? Ab initio means right from the very beginning. From the very beginning when it was made, when it was thought, when the ideas were exchanged, when the proposal was made, when the offer was made, during that time itself, it was void. It would never have been enforceable by law. Never. Nature and the character. Illegal agreements are void since the very beginning. From the very beginning means void ab initio. They are invariably described as void ab initio. As already emphasized, see, why am I reading word by word? Why am I reading word by word? Because this is the language which you need to write in the examination hall. So, the way we are preparing, nobody else in the entire country is preparing. Because we are preparing at a very slow and a very steady way. Each and every word of the institute we are trying to cover. We are trying to understand the grasp, the language of the book. We are trying to understand the keywords, the important words, the examples. So this is the best preparation. It is taking some more time, but trust me, the revision time will get shortened. Generally, what happens is the understanding time is short, revision time is more. Here, the understanding time is more, revision time will be short. And the whatever you are understanding will remain in your mind and your heart, in your subconscious, even 20 years from now. Trust me on that. So, as already emphasized, under the scope of a contract by nature, which is valid, can subsequently change its character and become void. So, nature and character of the valid agreement or valid contract changes at times. So, we have discussed that case. When it changes, when the law changes. Effect on collateral transactions. In the case of illegal contract, even the collateral transactions, namely transactions which are to be compiled with, before or after, or concurrently along with the main contract, also becomes not enforceable. So basically, you need to murder someone. So there's a contract of murder. But there's a separate contract for car hire. Or you need to kidnap someone. So the contract of kidnapping is there, but a parallel contract, because you need to kidnap in a car. So there's a parallel contract with the car hire person of hiring the car. So the entire event where you wanted to kidnap the person, that kidnapping contract, that car hiring contract, and everything related with that is not enforceable. In contrast, in case of voidable contracts, the collateral transactions can be enforced despite the fact that the main contract may have become voidable. To the extent that collateral transactions are capable of being performed independently. So, voidable contract, if there is some other entanglements to it, but that has no association, no relationship, so it can be performed. But in case of illegal, everything related to illegal, let's say the kidnapping money, and with the kidnapping money you want to buy a television. So that money is with the kidnapping money, so it's poison. So illegal means poison, so anything related to poison is poison. You cannot bifurcate the collateral and the main agreement. The main agreement is illegal, so everything is illegal. So put it very simple, everything associated with illegal is illegal. Penalty or punishment. All illegal agreements are punishable under different laws, like the Indian Penal Code, etc. Whereas parties to void agreements do not face such penalties or punishments. So difference can be summarized. Well, this is for self-reading. This is summarized. Self-reading. Next is unenforceable contract. Unenforceable contract, they are good in substance, but because of some technical defect, that is absence in writing or barred by limitation. Limitation Act, basically, let's say it gives you some time frame. In case of some debt, let's say, for example, if the debt can be claimed within 3 years, and now already 3 years have passed, so now you cannot enforce the contract. One or both the parties cannot sue upon it. It is described as an unenforceable contract. You cannot get it enforced. So now we come to the second basis. Second basis is on the basis of formation. On the basis of formation of contract, express contract. Express means expressed by words or in writing. Section 9 of the Act provides that if the proposal or acceptance of any promise is made in words, the promise is said to be express. So express means it is made in words or in writing. So this fellow telephones, wants to sell his house for 2 lakhs. So this is an express contract. Implied when no words are used. That is, it comes in existence by implication. Implication can be by law or it can be by action. So this is very important. Implied by law or implied by the mutual action or reactions. Section 9 of the Act contemplates such implied contracts when it lays down that in so far as such proposal or acceptance is made, otherwise than in words, the promise is said to be implied. So no words was used. Let's say in a railway station, a coolie, he comes and just nothing was said, nothing was exchanged, just picks up your luggage and you allow the coolie to pick up the luggage. So it's implied that you are going to pay to the coolie. At the end, you cannot say, oh, come on, I did not ask you to pick up my luggage. I will not pay you. Or in case when at times, you know, there's a bus on the particular route, you just simply, you know that this bus is plying in this route. You simply board the bus, you take a seat. Later on, you cannot say the conductor, come on, there was no offer, there was no acceptance. I'm not under any sort of liability to pay you. It's implied. It's implied if you board the bus, we did not need to speak. There need not be any offer acceptance. The conductor will not come and tell you, hey, come on, offer denge pehle aapko, let me give you the offer. You need to accept, then contract. No, it's understood. Without even saying, it's understood that you are under a duty to perform. The bus has already performed the duty by picking, the bus picked you up from a poor spot. The bus is dropping you where you want to get dropped. So the bus is already performing the duty. So it's your duty to perform. Your duty of performance is pay the fare. That's it. You need not speak, but you need to perform. So here we got the example of the coolie. Now the same thing, tacit contracts. Tacit contracts. Tacit contract is also implied contracts, where nothing is, no words is exchanged, no offer, no acceptance. It happens at the ATM machine. The ATM machine cannot, that poor fellow cannot speak. You go and say, hi ATM machine, how are you man? The ATM machine will not answer anything. Okay. So this is silent contracts. But you enter your PIN number and everything, the machine gives you the money. Okay. So tacit means silent. Tacit contracts are those that is inferred through the conduct of the parties without any words spoken or written. Classic example of tacit contract would be when cash is withdrawn by the customer or a bank from an automatic teller machine, that is ATM. The other example of tacit is auction sale. So it is not separate form of contract, but falls within the scope of implied contracts. So we are done with tacit contracts, my friends. The example is fall of a hammer, that is auction sale or ATM machine. So when you're dealing with machines, it is tacit contracts. But when you're dealing with human beings, no words said, it is implied contract. Okay. Implied contract, tacit contract. So what is the difference? There is no difference. Tacit contract and implied contract are same. asset means basically absolute silence, because you're dealing with a machine. Even if you say something, the machine is going to remain silent. But in case of an implied contract, later on at least the driver or the conductor can speak something. Come on, man, why should I give you? At least later on they can speak. But the contract was entered even without speaking. Later on at least they can speak. But with the machine will never speak. So never speak, it is tacit. So next is quasi-contract. What is quasi-contract? Let's say if you are, suppose, by mistake, you receive a sweet, mithai, sweet box, or chocolate. Chocolate was supposed to be delivered to Mr. Narayan Swami, but it got delivered in the house of Mr. Muthu Swami. Later on, Muthu Swami is saying, "Oh my God, God, you love me so much. God, today I wanted to eat a chocolate. Oh God, you love me. My Lord Venkatesh, you love me so much. You sent the chocolate to me." But Muthu knows this chocolate was for Narayan. The chocolate, he is not the real owner. "Oh my Lord, he loves me so much. My God, oh my God, the God can understand my feeling so well. The God can understand my feeling. God loves me. He sent the chocolate. I had the chocolate. Now I will not give you the chocolate because I have already finished it." Can Muthu Swami do something of this sort? No. It is the duty of Muthu Swami to give the chocolate back to Narayan Swami. But Muthu is saying, "No, I have finished the chocolate. It was very tasty. I felt like eating because it is God's will." So Muthu Swami cannot say ki I will not give the chocolate to Narayan Swami. So a duty is automatically imposed by law. The duty is called, there's a law of unjust enrichment. Unjust enrichment. Unjust means which is not justice. The chocolate belonged to Narayan Swami, but it was delivered at the house of Muthu Swami. And this is not justice, because it was delivered by mistake at your house, so you eat it. And then you say, "It is not my mistake." If somebody comes to your house, by mistake they leave the money bag, and then you say, "Oh my God, God, you love me so much. Because God, you love me so much," then only you did some magic that fellow left the money bag here. So this is not magic, this is called unjust enrichment. You are getting rich at the expense of somebody else. So the duty is, you please give it back to the person whom it belongs. So let's say you find a lost good, lost and found. On the road you are traveling, you find something. Or in the bus seat you find something. You don't know who it belongs to whom. So that doesn't mean ki since you got it, so you are the owner of it. No, you are not the owner. It is your duty to look out for the real owner. How can I look out? How can I find out? You have to try. This is the law. If you find a money bag, try to look out any identity card, any name. If you get something, it's good. You need to try. Basically, you cannot claim that you got it, so now you are the owner. So you cannot do that. So a quasi-contract is not an actual contract. Why? Because in actual contract, you get actual duty. And that actual duty is defined by both the parties. But it resembles a contract. It is not an actual duty, but it resembles as if you have a duty in contract. There's in a similar way, you are duty bound. Quasi-contract, you are duty bound. In the real contract, again you are duty bound. Quasi-contract, was there a real contract between you and the person who left his good, who lost his good? Was a contract? No. It is created by law. So who is creating this contract? Law is creating the contract. Under certain circumstances, the law creates and enforces legal rights and obligations when no real contract exists. So in a situation, let's say cricket bat, somebody finds a bat lying and brings the bat home. "Ki, I am a lucky guy, I found a bat, so now this bat belongs to me." No. So it is the legal right of the person who is the real owner to go and take the bat back from you, and it is your duty to give the bat back to him. Otherwise, everybody will find something from the road and they will all become owners. Such obligations are known as quasi-contracts. In other words, it is a contract in which there is no intention part of either party to make a contract, but law imposes a contract upon the parties. So it is the law which is imposing the rights and the duties. So this is this example is the same example. You need to give it to the true owner. What is e-contract? E-contract is the contract which we are doing with Amazon, Flipkart, etc. So electronic data interchange. So this you can also self-read. So on the basis of performance of the contract, so executed, both the parties have performed, executed. So in the sugar and cash, the grocer example, executory can be divided into two parts, unilateral and bilateral. So bilateral is a case where both the parties needs to do something. Let's say here the plot is of 1 lakh rupee, only 25,000 has been given. So he needs to give 75,000 and he needs to register the plot, give the plot to him. So both the parties have something left to be done. So it is bilateral. Only one party example can be, let's say, flight tickets. Flight tickets. I have made the payment. Now, Jet Airways, it is the Jet Airways duty to take me to Delhi, from Kolkata to Delhi. So it is unilateral. So I think we are more or less done with the types of contract today. So types of contract we have done today. So validity, formation or performance. So dear friends, we will continue tomorrow, next day. Next day we will start with proposal. So we'll discuss about the proposal of a section next day. So enjoy, keep learning, keep going at a slow pace, keep reading the ICAI material. It is the best material. And if you prepare yourself with ICAI study material, nobody can stop you from clearing in the first attempt. So the whole idea is clear your exams. There should not be any sort of fear. Don't be scared. One each and every word we will study, we will understand, we will explain. Then we will teach you how to write the answers in the examination hall. We will take up the previous year question papers. So everything we will be doing. So don't worry. Keep enjoying. You should enjoy your studies. There should not be any force. So I love you all. Take care. Bye-bye.